Hello, my name is George Lisensky. I'm a professor of chemistry at Beloit College in Wisconsin. I'm also a member of the Materials Research, Science, and Engineering Center on Nanostructured Interfaces. My goal is to tell you about some applications of nanotechnology. I'll include some things that are being done now and some things that might be done in the future. Greta pointed out in her introductory presentation that things are different at the nanoscale than at the macro scale. For example, properties change with size. She mentioned that particles of gold become red at the nanoscale. Gold nanoparticles also change color depending on the distance between them. Gold nanoparticles separated by large citrate ions look red, as shown on the left. Gold nanoparticles separated by small chloride ions look blue, as shown on the right. The difference between the two test tubes is that salt water has been added to the first, and the smaller chloride ions allow the gold nanoparticles to get closer together and change color. This change in color with spacing has been used to test for specific sequences of DNA. You attach single-stranded DNA to the nanoparticles and then add a sequence for DNA testing. When a DNA sequence matches, the particles are held closer together and provide a rapid color test for that sequence. Another interesting material is made with nanoparticles of magnetite suspended in a liquid. Magnetism is a property of solids, but if the solid particles are small enough, then the liquid containing the particles appears to be magnetic. Here, a magnet is lowered over the liquid. The nanoparticles and liquid leap toward the magnet and illustrate the magnetic field lines. Ferrofluid is used for applications where the liquid would not stay put, such as in spinning rotors or in zero gravity. Here, a magnet is moved under the liquid, and again, the nanoparticles and the liquid follow the magnetic field lines. Potential medical applications would attach drugs or antibodies to the nanoparticles. Magnets could then be used to move the particles to the needed location, for example, to deliver medicine to tumors or to remove toxins from the body. Graphite and diamond are two well-known forms of the element carbon. Another form is a carbon nanotube that can be pictured as being made from a rolled-up sheet of graphite. The nanotube can be an electrical conductor or a semiconductor, depending on how the sheet is rolled. Carbon nanotubes are in the lab are not actually made by rolling graphite sheets, but they can be made several different ways. A promising method uses a metal catalyst to decompose hydrocarbons at high temperatures. The catalyst is lifted up as this tube grows. In the picture, you can see where one of the metal spheres has fallen off. Placing the catalyst in specific locations can control where the carbon nanotubes are grown. Old-fashioned television and computer displays had an electron source that was guided by electromagnetic fields to light pixels and form an image. The picture on the left shows such a cathode ray tube. A single electron gun has to be guided over the surface of the display to create the pixels. The rod-like shape of carbon nanotubes could provide a separate electron source for each pixel, as shown on the right, thus allowing a much narrower display device. Both Samsung and Motorola are experimenting with carbon nanotube field effect displays that would make large screen, inexpensive, flat panel displays and televisions. Carbon nanotubes are very strong, and they've been proposed as a cable for a space elevator. Originally, this idea comes from science fiction. The idea is that you put one end of the cable in orbit and have the cable long enough to reach the ground. Large objects could be transported up the cable, like Jack and the Beanstalk. Steel, however, is not strong enough to support the weight of the cable. Carbon nanotubes might be, although the strength of the tube depends strongly on the number of defects in the chemical structure of the tube. The required strength is shown in blue here, and the yellow is the actual strength. Neither steel nor Kevlar are possible space elevator cables. Carbon nanotubes might be, but only if the carbon nanotubes are perfect. If you include the defects that occur in currently made nanotubes, then you're only about half as strong as needed. When designing an elevator, you might also want to include a significant safety margin. The technology does not yet exist to make a long enough carbon nanotube. The longest known carbon nanotube is about 1 centimeter long. To reach to orbit, you need about 36,000 kilometers. Longer tubes would also have more defects. Even if such a cable could be made, reactions with atomic oxygen atoms and damage by micrometeorites pose additional problems. Progress has been made spinning carbon nanotubes into yarn. Here we see a forest of carbon nanotubes at the right being pulled off into a fiber. As those fibers are pulled off and spun, you can create a carbon nanotube yarn. The same researchers have also experimented in pulling carbon nanotubes into sheets. And so here we see a transparent carbon nanotube sheet a whole meter long being created. Such sheets are strong and lightweight and transparent and electrically conducting. They can support 50,000 times their own weight. Carbon nanotubes also absorb wavelengths of light that are not absorbed by the human body. If carbon nanotubes were modified to attach to cancer cells, you could then shine that wavelength of light on a patient and cook the cancer cells. A nanotechnology application already being sold is window glass containing titanium dioxide nanoparticles. The nanoparticles absorb ultraviolet light to break down dirt. Rainwater then spreads out on the surface and washes the dirt away. In this figure, we see nanoparticle-treated glass on the left and untreated glass on the right. The nanoparticle material is much easier to see through and is a much better window glass. Self-cleaning glass is found in the windows of this sports arena that was used as the base for the winning Italian soccer team in the 2006 World Cup. Rather than spreading out water droplets in a sheeting action, some materials have many small bumps to make water bead up. This is called the Lotus Effect, after the leaves where the effect was first studied. This animation shows tiny drops of water rolling off a lotus leaf. And as the drops of water roll off, they would carry particles of dirt away with them. The Lotus Effect can also keep your clothes clean. Fine nanofibers prevent wetting of some new fabrics. If the stain never touches the fabric won't get dirty. Another commercial product using nanomaterials are Wilson double core tennis balls that have a clay nanocomposite. That's a mixed polymer with nanoparticles of clay. This produces a flexible rubber with improved gas barrier properties. This is shown in the lower right. And if the material is still bouncy, but it doesn't allow gas to permeate through it, then you have produced a tennis ball that won't lose its bounce. This also has potential applications for bicycle tires that would never go flat. To summarize, nanotechnology applications are already affecting our lives in diverse ways as self-cleaning windows and self-cleaning clothes, new medical tools, and improved materials. What do you see in this picture that's nano? Even the display screens here are made of light-emitting diodes, another nanotechnology application. If you would like to learn more about these and other applications of nanotechnology, visit our website at mrsec.wis.edu/nano.